KCPT gets ready to mark Memorial Day with Celebration at the Station, our annual partnership with the Kansas City Symphony.
Symphony conductor Michael Stern is with us this half hour. This year's event at Union Station features a special welcome home tribute for Vietnam veterans, the welcome home they never received.
This is the 50th anniversary of the first American casualties in what was to become known as the Vietnam War. We talk with a Kansas City man who has devoted his life to offering support and dignity to Vietnam vets.
We head to the Flint Hills, where great music is meeting the great outdoors.
And we bring you the Overland Park teenager who's getting national media attention for being one of America's most business-savvy kids.
Principal funding for the local show provided by Frederick and Louise Hartwig Family Fund, Kauffman Foundation, Francis Family Foundation, Toy and Miniature Museum of Kansas City, Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, Sprint Foundation, Hall Family Foundation, Hallmark Cards Incorporated, Muriel McBrien Kauffman Foundation, and KCPT supporters like you. Thank you.
And I'm Randy Mason. Welcome to The Local Show. It may seem hard to believe, but this year marks the 50th anniversary of America's involvement in Vietnam. The Kansas City Symphony is marking the anniversary at their Celebration at the Station event this weekend at Union Station.
More on that in just a moment, but first meet the Kansas City man who has devoted his life to supporting Vietnam vets. His name is Art Fillmore. He's an attorney, decorated Vietnam vet, founder of a foundation that helps homeless veterans, and for more than 25 years has been chairman of the Kansas City Vietnam Veterans Memorial in Westport.
And he's been speaking with local show guest host Cynthia Wheeler-Linden.
Vietnam was an interesting war for this country. Many of the soldiers came back, you yourself came back, without a hero's welcome, similar to some of the things we've seen in movies. But how would you share your experience based on the differences that you experienced and what we're seeing today with soldiers?
Well, I think that, first of all, one of the values of the Vietnam veterans' experience is that we finally learn to respect the warrior, if not the war. And there's a distinction there that I think our country finally makes, that regardless what you think about the battle, those in the battle should be respected and honored. When I came back from Vietnam, I went back to the University of Missouri in Columbia, where I had gone to school, to see my old fraternity brothers. And I was watching a football game, and Missouri scored a touchdown. They fired off the cannon. I jumped down behind my seat, and all my fraternity brothers go, "Man, you've turned weird." I said, "Well, I think I was weird before I went."
A little jumpy, but explainable.
But it was, you know, and I really felt like an outcast. Mm-hmm. And the World War II generation didn't have much respect for Vietnam veterans at the time. They said, "You know, you're losing a war." So I just shut up about it. And it wasn't until 1985, when I began to work on the Vietnam Veterans Memorial, that I ever really shared my experiences. And unfortunately, when you don't talk about, when you repress those memories, you're likely to come up with post-traumatic stress disorder, and that's probably something I suffered from for a number of years.
Before it was addressed, well, you said you came back and you were suffering from a lot of things, and the level of respect given to you as a war hero, a silent hero, was minimal by this country. Most people projected their concerns or disagreement about the war on the soldiers themselves. Were you asked to come back in civilian clothing, or did you wear your uniform with pride?
I did not wear my uniform with pride. I came back, I went to Germany after Vietnam. I was discharged at Fort Dix in New Jersey, and I took my uniform off about as quickly as I could, because people literally would treat you with derision when they saw you in a uniform coming back, and they would talk about you know, the baby killers and all. I mean, the stereotypes are true. That's really the way people reacted toward it.
Right.
So I just took it off, put it away, and never really looked at it for a long time.
Let's talk about the war itself, the Vietnam War. It has been compared to our experiences in the Middle East over the last 10 years, and we still have a war ongoing there. But for Vietnam, would you say we lost that war?
Well, you know, I think militarily that's always been the conclusion, but one of the things that was really cathartic for me and helpful to me is that in 1994 and 1995, I went back to Vietnam six times on behalf of Heart to Heart International, which does humanitarian work and medical missions, and they had asked me to be the volunteer chair of a group to go back and deliver $10 million worth of medical supplies in hospitals throughout the country, from Women and Children's Hospital in Hanoi to a leper colony south of Saigon. And in going back there, I met a lot of people I'd fought against. And in fact, the Minister of Agriculture had been someone I'd fought directly against in a firefight in Cambodia. And we talked many, many times about it. And he finally said, you know, you Americans are too tough on yourselves. He said, you wanted to stop the spread of communism, and no one's gone communist since you were here. You wanted to have an economic impact in Southeast Asia. We're now welcoming you back with open arms. And you want to have a cultural influence in Southeast Asia, and clearly you've had that. What is it that you think, why you think you lost? And it gave me a perspective that was very, very helpful to me.
You also had, or you founded an organization that is good about reaching out to veterans. Can you tell us the name of that, a little bit about it, and what we as a community can do to help you move forward in your endeavor with supporting local veterans?
Sure. So we set up the Heart of America Stand Down Foundation for Homeless Veterans in 1992. We did our first event in 1993, and we're still doing them.
When's your next event?
June 3rd and 4th this year.
So we're just right after.
Yeah, right. It'll be at the Scottish Rite Temple. We'll have between 750 and 800 vets and their families go through, as well as over 600 to 700 volunteers participate. It's a big event. What we could use are clean underwear, towels, clothing of that nature, and cash.
And cash. Yeah, so bottom line, veterans are able to come in and get what services on this particular two-day event?
What we tell them is we're a hand up, not a handout, and we'd like to help them get off the streets. So we offer them clothing, haircuts, all sorts of counseling services. We had 90 agencies there last year, from Social Security to VA to Department of Labor, job people, everything you can imagine. We hold court on Saturday at the municipal court, and we actually dispose of about 125 cases of small things like vagrancy and trespassing, which keep vets from getting jobs. President Obama and Secretary Shinseki have put in a five-year plan to end homelessness among veterans, and so I'm really trying to do our part to help execute
that locally.
That plan.
Locally. Well, we're glad you're doing that. Now, my last one is the Vietnam Veterans Memorial that you have been a part of, and were you a co-chair of?
I was the second chair. I am the chair of it still. We started that. We dedicated on September the 6th of 1986. Uh-huh. It honors not only those 385 people on the wall who were either killed or missing, but also the flowing water is symbolic of the life of those of us who've come back in a productive society.
So getting that memorial up and started was the same struggle you sort of experienced heading home after
Vietnam. It was actually worse, because we had built the wall. We were out of money. Every night I had a dream of parents saying, you've got to finish this memorial. My son's name is on the memorial. You've got to finish it. It haunted me like nothing I've ever had before. And ironically, on March 31st of 1986, the wall was vandalized by a young misguided man who put swastikas and anti-American slogans on the wall, and a grease paint that baked into the wall because of the sun the next day. So it brought a big rally of Kansas City, that this wall meant something, this memorial meant something. And it was really the arrival of the famous philanthropist Del Dunmire, who called me and said, I saw what happened down there, I want to finish the memorial. And so Del helped us get the memorial finished. But it was it's one of the real most important things of my life, because I can go down there, I can see it, I can see people enjoying it, I can see both the love of the pain, the sorrow, and the hope that it engenders, and it's very rewarding.
Absolutely. Well, I will tell you this. I had the opportunity to talk to Colonel Bob Lewis, who worked with you, and he wanted to make sure that everyone knew that Art is the kind of guy that does good things because it's the right thing to do. And so we appreciate you taking time out of your day and continuing to do the right thing for Vietnam veterans and for veterans here in Kansas City.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that very much.
Thanks.
Thank you.
The Kansas City Symphony will mark the 50th anniversary of the start of the Vietnam War in its Celebration at the Station event Sunday night at Union Station. Symphony conductor Michael Stern will be with us in just a moment on the local show.
It's an exciting time at the Symphony as it prepares to enter its new home at the Kauffman Center for the Performing Arts this fall. The Symphony is trying to whet people's appetites by offering video portraits of what the move will mean to its longtime supporters.
Thank you. I really love music. In the symphony concerts, I have what I would only describe as a transcendent experience. I experience things there that I don't experience any other place or any other way. Everything from actual sadness to extreme joy. And as we approach the move-in to the Performing Arts Center, I am absolutely filled with anticipation and excitement because I know that everything that I've experienced already will just be magnified.
This would be a really cool seat.
And I really can't wait for that day.
Well, it's the time of the year here where I get used to seeing our next guest's back as much as anything else, because that's the way he's facing when he's conducting the Kansas City Symphony, particularly at the Union Station for Celebration at the station. Michael Stern, the music director and conductor of the Kansas City Symphony, welcome.
Thank you. Great to be here. My back is my best side, possibly. So.
Well, since the last time I saw you, actually, you have collected a Grammy Award, among other things.
Our last recording, yes, happily, Britain's Orchestra was the title of the CD. It was all music of Benjamin Britten, and we're very proud of it. It came out very nicely.
Yeah, I would say so. Getting a Grammy is a pretty great achievement for an orchestra that, you know, you are building in your sixth season now.
Yeah, it's a pretty heady time for us, and it's really gratifying to know that the work is starting to pay off. We have a lot of great stuff coming up. I mean, we're not sitting on our laurels at all, but it's nice to know that certain things are falling into place so beautifully, and the musicians, I mean, it really sits on their shoulders as much as anything else. It's incredible, the experience of working with musicians this talented and this committed makes all the difference in the world.
Certainly there must have been some surprises over what you came in thinking you were going to face, and I don't mean just musically, but the job of...
You mean originally when I came in? Oh, you know, I was still am in a way, dyed-in-the-wool, born and bred New Yorker. And I was an American history major in college. I should have had more awareness of what the Midwest was generally, and Kansas City specifically. But like a lot of other people, I found this incredible city. And now Kansas City feels it's home. And the orchestra it's something really special.
I think that's interesting that you were an American history major. Everyone would assume that was a music degree right out of the chute, given your upbringing.
Well, you know, we played music, my siblings and I, from a very early age. It was part of our natural evolution, natural education. And we were, you know, allowed to make our own choices. I think music came back to claim me as much as I claimed it as a profession. I did think for a brief, idiotic moment that I was going to be a lawyer. Took the LSATs, you know,
really? but
I don't think the world misses that I was not chosen by the legal profession. I think everybody should be happy about that. Certainly I am.
Well, you appear to be a man who, you have two small children, young
I
children.
Do. You're 4 and a half and 2 and a quarter. And my wife Shelley and I spend a lot of sleepless nights waiting for them to learn to sleep through the night, but it's all good.
As this world traveling guy too, I mean, you talk about Kansas City and how much you like being here, but the truth is, you are often everywhere, it would seem like.
Conductors are peripatetic, and that's sort of, it goes with the territory, and when you have young kids, that's hard, yeah. But somehow we make it work.
And give us an idea of that itinerary. Which countries, which places might you go in, or have been in?
You know, have baton, will travel. You know, I was, go to Europe, and I was in England not so long ago. I'm going to Spain in a couple of weeks. I've got stuff lined up across this country. I mean, you go where the gigs are, but you also need a focus, and happily the focus very much is the Kansas City Symphony. And it also, it makes you a different kind of musician, because you're responsible for things in the organization that you never would be as a guest conductor, as it should be. And there again, there's a great deal of joy in being able to build something in a way that's more than just the concerts. Concerts are what it's all about. I mean, making music not only week to week, but for the community on an ongoing way, building season after season, bringing things to happen, making things happen in the community, all of that is part of the job. And it goes beyond any one individual concert. And that's a very enriching thing. It's a very rewarding thing.
And of course, looking ahead, you can't not have your eye on the prize, which of course is a new place to play.
Well, it certainly is a prize, and it's a pretty huge prize. It's a once-in-a-lifetime thing. The Kauffman Center for the Performing Arts is transformational in every single way. And this past week, we already started rehearsing. We're not going to be playing concerts until the official opening next September, but we've been in there testing out the acoustics, getting used to the room, and it has exceeded all of our incredibly high expectations. I mean, you know, the Kauffman people, they chose this wonderful architect. The building looks beautiful. It is this shining moment for the city's landscape, and it is a kind of flash point. It's a lightning rod for a lot of the artistic buzz that was happening anyway around Kansas City. But when you get inside, especially the Helzberg Hall, to the dedicated concert hall, because there's also a theater, the Opera Theater, the Proscenium Theater, is also wonderful, but Helzberg Hall is a miracle. And when people experience that, it's going to change completely the way they listen to the music. They're going to hear things for the first time. The orchestra is going to be transformed as well. And the experience of having the art work on you is going to be something utterly new and utterly fantastic.
Were you a big player in helping them shape those acoustics?
Well, they stacked the deck pretty well by hiring what I think is the best acoustician in the world. He's responsible for Suntory Hall in Tokyo, for the Disney Hall in LA. Yasu Toyoda is kind of a genius. And he's, what's most admirable about him is that he's a musician's acoustician. And he really understands the artistic side of things, not just the science. He's great on the science, but he blends the science and the art and the kind of witchcraft of acoustics into this phenomenally transparent and utterly beautiful thing. I mean, the room can thunder and it can take the heft, and you can hear a pin drop and everything in between. It's great.
Well, let's jump back now to a place where the acoustics may not be so great, but the experience is always awesome. I'm talking about Union Station.
That celebration at the station has become another iconic event for the entire community. And an overwhelming experience for us. And actually, you know, the acoustics are not that bad. The way the shell is set up and the amplification really works for a crowd that I think last year was skirting at 50,000 people.
Well, it's been a real joy to be a part of and to see that build, see the energy happen. This year, the theme, it takes a little more focus than it has sometimes. Let's talk about that.
Well, it is the anniversary of the Vietnam War, and that is appropriate. I mean, Memorial Day still is about something larger than just the holiday weekend to kick off the summer. And the Vietnam War and recognizing all the sacrifices made during that period. I think as a nation, we never really thanked those people well enough and acknowledged what happened and how much was lost and how lots of people suffered. We've always put together, I think, programs which really touch on the meaning behind the event. And I think this year is going to be that and more.
Adagio for strings, perhaps, Barber. And
in fact, yes, among other things.
It would seem like one of those ones that you really, you know.
Well, we have great guests for the concert. I mean, we have Mark O'Connor, who's this tremendous, I mean, of course, famous fiddler. And he's always fun, and he's got some great charts, and that's just a kick. Ben Gully, who's been with us before, who's a fantastic singer and was so brilliant 2 years ago, he's coming back with us. We have the United States Air Force, the Brass and Blue, coming to be with us. And and of course, our MC, the whole thing is being organized with Jim Birdsall.
And good luck with the 5-hour energy drinks to keep to keep the pace up, sir.
Yeah, well, there's a lot of caffeine, a lot of coffee late at night. It's all good.
Well, thanks for joining us here, Michael Stern, on The Local Show. Good luck with all those things that the Kansas City Symphony has on its plate.
Thank you. It's always a pleasure.
In a few weeks, the Kansas City Symphony will head west without Michael Stern for their annual Symphony in the Flint Hills concert. Associate conductor Stephen Jarvie will lead the orchestra as they perform before a sold-out audience, an audience that has embraced the idea of great music meeting the great outdoors, as you're about to see in this piece produced by Amy Larrabee.
Rolling green hills and wide open vistas. This is Kansas's tall grass prairie, home each June to the Symphony in the Flint Hills. This year, conductor Stephen Jarvie will return with the Kansas City Symphony to fill the Flint Hills with music that evokes the spirit of the American prairie. This selection from last year's concert, Symphony on a Hymn Tune, was written by Kansas City's own Virgil Thompson, who will be the focus of a national PBS program that Kcpt is co-producing. Excerpts like these will allow audiences across the country to not only hear the beautiful works of Thompson, but to savor some of the landscape that inspired and informed some of his most powerful compositions. While the Kansas City Symphony provides the artistic focus, Symphony in the Flint Hills Incorporated is a separate organization with a mission of using symphonic music to heighten appreciation of the tall grass prairie ecosystem. The event was inspired by a birthday celebration back in 1994 when Flint Hills rancher Jane Coger invited the people of Chase County to a symphony on the prairie. Jane organized and produced this symphony with an all-woman orchestra whose members came from the symphony orchestras of St. Louis, Denver, and Kansas City to perform in a natural amphitheater on her homestead ranch. More than 3,000 people, not only from Chase County, but from around the Midwest and beyond, sat in lawn chairs and on blankets with their neighbors and new friends. They experienced the magic of symphonic music wafting on the evening prairie breeze, accompanied by grass and sky as far as the eye could see, along with a gorgeous Kansas sunset for the finale. Jane's stated goal for this event is to provide an experience of great music in the Flint Hills and bring together art and environment to nourish the soul. No politics and no hidden agendas, just a simple pairing of music and prairie. Each year, the concert is staged at a different private ranch within the Tallgrass Prairie. This year's concert, once again sold out, will take place near Alma, Kansas on June 11th.
In the words of Monty Python, and now for something completely different. An Overland Park teenager is getting some national media attention this week for his financial savvy. 17-year-old Jeffrey Hanson, a junior at the Horizon Academy in Roland Park, which specializes in teaching children with learning disabilities, has just been featured on the national PBS show Biz Kids. Why? Well, because since the age of 14, he's been a stock trader, turning his homemade art into big-time investments.
I'm Jeff. I'm a painter. And I'm also a stock market investor. We assume that I was born with an F, but nobody really knows. Neurofibromatosis is a genetic disorder, can cause a tumor, and I have one sitting on my optic nerve. My tumor's name was Claude. He was my little nemesis. Once I got to sixth grade, I started chemotherapy. I started painting for something fun to do during chemotherapy and radiation. My first real commission when I got paid was at age 13, but my eye doctor asked me to do a canvas for the charity that she supports the most, and that's how I really started to do canvases and painting. So overall, I've painted 668 canvases. I've donated over $200,000 to charity. Everything down here currently is a commission of some sort, and that is what allows me to buy my stocks. Why I bought stock when I was 14 and started my IRA when I was 14. I think it is important for every kid to have some sort of mentor before they buy stocks. I asked people that I knew that have been successful, and they said, well, you should get ones that you trust that are blue chip stocks, and I listened. These are all my investments. The stocks that I have are ProQS, Microsoft, Williams Pipeline, Yum China, because I bought Yum and it's also in China, General Electric. Oh, I forgot it, and I also have Berkshire Hathaway. I wrote Warren Buffett a letter when I was like 14 or 15 saying, I hope to someday meet you and maybe buy one of your stocks. He's the CEO of Berkshire Hathaway and he is worth $62 billion. So I felt like I made a great decision buying his stock after I saw it seems to always do well. I buy a new stock ever at the beginning of every year for my Roth IRA. If I have the funds to buy new stocks, I'll buy one or two more in that year. For kids that are investing in the stock market of any age, my advice is buy what you believe in and what you understand. I don't have to see my stocks to know that they're earning me cash.
Congratulations to Overland Park teenager Jeffrey Hanson, featured on the national PBS financial literacy show, Biz Kids. Biz Kids runs every Sunday afternoon at 4:30 on KCPT. By the way, you can see that video segment and every video we've run on The Local Show again and again on our website, thelocalshow.org. I'm Nick Haynes. We'll see you next time on The Local Show.
Principal funding for The Local Show provided by Frederick and Louise Hartwig Family Fund, Kauffman Foundation, Francis Family Foundation, Toy and Miniature Museum of Kansas City, Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, Sprint Foundation, Hall Family Foundation, Hallmark Cards Incorporated, Muriel McBrien Kauffman Foundation, and KCPT supporters like you. Thank you.